welcome Victor Müller. Welcome to Stockholm, Victor Müller.
Thank you very much.
You have now controlled Saab for 2 years, and it's been a bumpy ride to keep that brand alive.
That's being putting it mildly. It's been very bumpy.
How would you characterize the situation now?
Very tough. Very tough.
How come?
Well, we made a deal with the Chinese to sell the company, but that transaction is subject to certain approvals, including one from General Motors. And the structure that we made was not very much appreciated. So General Motors is not in agreement. So we have to go back to the drawing board and cook up something that will work. But that is not very easy. So we're working day, night, as usual. And we try to come up with something that will work and will provide sufficient lifeline for the company, for it to succeed in the years to come.
And GM is the huge American company. What are their rights in Saab?
Well, they have so-called change of control clauses in basically every single important agreement that we have with them. When they sold the company had certain licensed technologies in it. The cars we currently build are under a license from General Motors. The 94X, which is our new crossover car, is built entirely by GM. And the supply agreement says that if another manufacturer takes more than 20% of the shares in Saab, they have the right to terminate. So it's all these contracts are drafted to protect the interests of General Motors as the license giver.
And while you are trying to sell to the Chinese, GM won't accept this?
Well, they won't accept that the Chinese take control, so that the technology in principle comes into their hands by just buying the company.
So who's to blame now? Is it the Americans? Is it the Chinese? Or who's to blame?
I don't think there's anyone to blame. The fact is that there were certain contracts that we were all very much aware of, and that we made an agreement that was in stark contrast to those agreements. So basically, by making that agreement, we ran a serious risk that the General Motors would say no, and that happened. So now we have to find an alternative structure.
You started out with a brand called Spyker, which is a very different kind of cars.
Very different.
I wonder, what's your business history? What is your greatest success this far in business?
I started off as a mergers and acquisitions lawyer in the international arena. And then I became managing director of the largest offshore conglomerate in the world, offshore construction, so oil rigs. And I did a buyout of one of the subsidiaries, and which was the ship towage company. And I built that up over a number of years, and it became extraordinarily successful. And we sold it to Maersk, to the Danes, and that generated a lot of cash. And then I did what I really wanted to do, start a car company. Mm. And most young guys, when you ask them what to do, they either want to be a policeman, or they want to be a race driver, or they want to build a car, right? And I did it. I didn't become a policeman, although I was very touched by the policeman who apologized for his daughter, right? Maybe I should be a policeman, actually. You can learn to say sorry. You need to say sorry, right?
Well, all of us. All of us.
And I do have a black book, too. More like a black library, actually. No, but I mean, that is what I did. And I started as an entrepreneur 20 years ago, starting by buying companies that were basically €1, or Gilder at the time, and turning them around.
You have quite a self-confidence.
Yeah, if you don't have self-confidence, you can't do this job, right? You have to have it. If you don't have it, and I'm sure you have the same situation, if you don't have self-confidence, you cannot do this job because people will take you down.
But do you also need a bit of naivety to be able to... I mean, to be a risk-taker?
No, you have to control your fear. I think that entrepreneurs control their fear in a different way, not necessarily a better way, but in a different way than other people. And you have to rationalize your fear, you have to control it, you have to deal with it. I deal with it in such a way that I can do the things I do. Some other people would probably declare me crazy. Maybe I am insane, because insanity is defined as doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different outcome. And maybe I do the same thing over and over again and one day I'll get a different outcome. But I enjoy what I do. And that's important. And I think that adds to your self-confidence. If you enjoy what you do and you have tasted success, which I definitely have, then you become addicted to that drug and you want to keep on tasting it.
You have one quite controversial friend called Vladimir Antonov.
Right.
He's a Russian banker now accused of embezzling. How did you two meet?
We met in 2005 at Le Mans, the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the famous iconic race. And it so happened that our pit boxes were next to each other. We were racing Spikers. He had his own team. And we met then, and 2 years later, when Spiker got into serious trouble, we entered into an adventure into Formula One that didn't really end very well. And as a result of which, we needed cash, and he was a true car lover. So he called me up and he said, "Can I be of any help?" I said, "Yes, you surely can be of any help." And he became a shareholder in Spiker at the time. We became very friendly, and in 2009, when Saab got into real trouble, we sat in his offices in London, and he said, "Should we not consider looking at buying Saab?" Because the deal with Koenigsegg, a small Swedish car maker, had just fallen apart. And I said, "Well, we never thought of it. Why don't we give it a shot?" And I sent an email to Bob Lutz, the then vice chairman of General Motors, and I knew him very well, so I said, "Bob, we're interested in buying Saab." And I joked with Antonov. I said, "Listen, Lutz always replies. He's glued to his BlackBerry. He always replies within a matter of minutes. The longest he had ever taken to reply to any of my emails was 13 minutes. And I said, "But this time it's going to be quicker." And 8 minutes later, Bob Lutz, "Vic, we'd be glad to entertain you. Get in touch with the guys at Deutsche Bank, and good luck with buying Saab." Well, those words, "good luck," resonated for quite a while, because we had really no idea what we were getting into.
What's Antonov's role today?
None. He left the company in February of 2010. He became my financier.
But was that because he was a liability to the
Well, company? it wasn't my choice. It was the choice of General Motors that he could not play a role in the company at the time. And we structured a transaction in such a way that he would be absolutely out, had no involvement in the company, and he still hasn't won today.
So he hasn't got any money or anything in Saab?
He has zero shares in Spiker. He has no money directly into Saab or Spiker or the parent company, Swedish Automobile.
When you say directly, do you mean...
Well, he has it indirectly, because in 2010, he financed me. What he did, he lent me 74 million euros in order to pay off all the debt that Spiker had to his banks, because his banks were excluded from the transaction too. So it was, in fact, a cash round, which was completely agreed with General Motors and the National Debt Office and European Investment Bank. It was something to basically clean the books of any financial involvement of Vladimir Antonov in the company.
Tell me, how did you... I mean, you borrowed a lot of money to buy Saab, but how did you finance your first car? How did it start?
Oh, that's... I went...